Okay, I'm calling this meeting to order at 6:33. This is the monthly meeting of the Manuscutney School District Board. And thank you, David. Let's see, first thing on our agenda is, well, calling to order. Changes to the agenda. I'd like to move the anti-racism and Jedi and Courtney portion to the first slot and agenda to this and budget to the second slot, unless anybody has any objections to that. Okay. Sorry, approval of our minutes from November 1st. I'll take a motion to approve the minutes as currently written.
So moved.
Second.
Shoot, my internet is unstable, everybody. So I may have to go off screen if anybody else in my house decides to use the internet. So forgive me, I'm here, but are there any comments or questions about the meetings as they're currently written? Okay, hearing none, I'm going to go down the list very, very quickly. Please say yes or no whether you approve the minutes from November 1st. Amy?
Yes.
Let's see. Davis?
Yes.
Okay. Nancy?
Yes.
Rebecca?
Yes.
And Bill?
Yes.
And I say yes. So that is, the meetings have, the minutes have been passed unanimously. And, oh man. Sorry. Don't answer. Okay.
Pam.
Okay. And the next item is, I believe, public participation, but just making sure. Public participation and announcements. Starting at our next meeting, we are going to have a line on our agenda which includes how to submit comments to the board if you are not able to attend a board meeting. And we'll discuss the way the board meeting will go, particularly about public comments later in this meeting, hopefully. But we'll also be discussing it at the SU board. Okay, so are there any public participants who would like to make a comment at this time? Speak now. Okay. Are there any announcements? Oh, I'd like to make an announcement. At the Windsor School this week, there is a play called Canned Hamlet, which runs on Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. Starring members of the seventh grade, and I'm not sure if there are members who are older than that, or actors who are older than that, but Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday of this week. And okay, are there any other announcements? Oop, I just heard a bloop.
I think the Canned Hamlet is our seventh and eighth grade, and okay. I think that's during the day, during class, and our evening performance is the high school Macbeth, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
Oh.
What? I can double.
What time does it start?
What time? Macbeth starts at 7 p.m., three nights in a row.
Okay, I thought it was, I thought Canned Hamlet was going on at 6:45.
You might know more than I do, Elizabeth. I will double check for you.
If you wouldn't mind, that would really be great.
You got it.
I would really hate to miss the
I'll check. Performance. You might be right. I'll check.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, are there any other announcements? Davis.
I just want to thank everyone who took part in the forum that we had down at the Welcome Center last Monday. I thought that went really well. And the recording should be up on Windsor on Air by now. I sent Paul the video, I think, end of last week. So, thanks. And looking forward to doing that, what, 3 more times the next year?
At least 2.
At least 2. Okay. All right.
I really think that as a follow-up, we should, I don't know if either of you or any of you had a chance to look at the documentary I suggested, but it's No Small Matter. And it's excellent. And I think it would really be a great, a friend of mine was one of the producers on it, and I can get him to come and speak to the audience. If we had a screening of it and then talked about it afterwards, I think it would be a really easy thing to do. So, and it would, I think, expand the conversation about the importance of such programs.
Elizabeth, if we wait for some warmer weather to do that too, we would be able to use the exchange space, which is great for screening movies and putting people in with a lot of good space if we're still having public health concerns.
Good idea. Okay, the next thing up is the principal's report. Thank you, Davis, and thank you everyone who participated, particularly Davis and Bill. And Jennifer and Katie and those of you who were in the audience. Much appreciated. Okay, principal's report. I'm gonna go off screen, forgive me, but I'm here.
Hi everyone. I just want to start by talking about kind of some general ideas that have been shared over the last month with us as administrators, which speak to what I think is the challenges of the times we are facing. We've gotten a lot of information over the last month, a little more than a month, about the challenges that our staff are facing. And I want to speak to that just a little bit as part of our principal's report, if you don't mind. It's not the traditional principal's report, but it speaks very closely, I think, to all of us going through some unusual times. And there are a couple of things that we have learned through listening to some of our staff members expressing what's going on. And I just want to share that with you, which is, I think the start of it is, we have a group of staff members, of teachers, who choose this profession because they wholeheartedly believe in the purpose of it. They give their all to it. They would do everything they can to make sure kids are taken care of and getting the best possible care they need. The challenge is, I think, right now, as I'm understanding the situation, I just had a conversation with our trauma specialist, Dave Melnick. I think the challenge that we're facing right now is that we're in the middle of a pandemic. So we're not in recovery mode, even though we're labeled in recovery mode. We are not only in the middle of the pandemic, we're in a pandemic that we're not just figuring out the beginning, and we're not through the kind of the stable part of it. We're in a part where, as a community, as human beings, there's supposed to be relief. And the relief hasn't come. And that leads to what, as we're seeing, is an overall increased level of stressors that impact all of us. And one of the things we know is that stress is contagious, and trauma is a community experience. Not one person, but all of us are impacted by it, because one person's stress actually can impact another person's stress. Same thing happens with regulation. So if somebody comes in pretty regulated, that also impacts us in that way. So our emotional states are primarily connected. That's how we evolved as human beings, is that our hippocampus tends to connect with other human beings. And we're in a phase right now where that's really impacting all of us. So our kids are coming in because their families are still many struggling in different ways. As a community, we're struggling with all kinds of barriers that are not usual for us. So because the kids come in at a level of stress, and we as adults come in with a level of stress, it's building on itself. And so that leads to when we have a demand placed on us and the skill set that we have within us can be pretty high. And when the demands are average or even somewhat elevated, which we've been experiencing, we've still got some pretty good adaptive, I think, skills that come to play. What's happening now is I think we've got this kind of ongoing stressors that create a chronic toxic kind of environment, not all the time, but sometimes, that is putting our staff in a position where they are feeling like they are constantly trying to have to do so much work that takes a whole lot of energy to do well, and they're doing it well. So I think as a part of the administrative team, I just want to acknowledge that our teachers are doing this amazing job of staying calm amidst a really tough time. They are helping our kids practice and develop skills and regulation. They are doing everything they can to support each other. One of the challenges of this time is we've got staff out a lot. I was just talking earlier about how at Albert Bridge, you know, five people out is about a third of our staff. That's hard when a third of your staff is out and you've got a lot of kids that you're trying to support. So people are playing so many different roles, and it's not one day or once every 5 days, it's every day. So many people are trying to play different roles. So all of this, as we talk and look forward, is leading to what I feel like is, first of all, growth opportunities for us as a school community and as a larger community, but also just to recognize that this is hard. This is really hard for our staff and our students and our families, and that we get it. We're not immune to it as administrators. I don't know. Most of you probably don't recall some of your principals in your classrooms when you were kids, but I know Kate, Colleen, and I have been in classrooms almost nonstop, subbing or supporting kids pretty continually. And these teachers are just doing a great job. So that's my part of the principal's part that I want to share. And I just want to highlight that I'm so appreciative of everything that all our teachers are doing.
If I could add, I would just like to say that the most important thing we can do is invest in each other. And when it's really hard, what gets us through is our team, our teamwork and our team attitude. And so when we invest in our coworkers, our students, our families, and our community that supports us, that's what gets us through when we have a lot of people absent because they can't help it because of this pandemic. So moving forward, anytime we are asking for support, and as we talk about the budget tonight, all of that support is in this way of building relationships and investing in each other to make that work.
Kate, anything you want to add?
No, you've been getting my almost daily love notes now, so I know you have an idea of what's going on here, but we're still plugging along. We won a football state championship. Bill Yates, that's for you. We won a field hockey state championship, and we are very excited and fingers crossed that we're going to pull off a play this week.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, Elizabeth.
Excellent. Okay, David, you're up with the thing. I should reflect on that first. I have been extremely concerned, as you all know, about the staff and administration, and anything we can do to support you, I think we should and we will. Just lead the way, and we're counting on you to lead the way. Anybody else have any reflections?
Thank you.
Okay, I don't hear any bloops. So, David, you're up.
Yeah, I'll try to make this brief. Just quickly, and I think this is part of what's driving the stress, is we've really had a spike in the COVID condition. First bullet, just that the winter athletics have begun. The high school started November 29th, 7th, and 8th. Could begin as early as today. I didn't hear whether they did or not. I assume they did. And K-6 will, of course, for Windsor and Mount Ascutney, that's a recreational program. So they've probably started already, but all the other 7th and 8th grade programs will start after January. TTS test to stay is more time consuming than we predicted. And of course it depends on case count, and the case counts have been high. Right now we've got 19, and Kate and Colleen, correct me if I'm wrong, but the last count was, I think, 19 positive cases in Windsor. And I think we had 30 kids doing tests to stay. Does that sound right, Kate or Colleen?
Yeah, we hit 20 this afternoon.
Okay, all right, so we add one to that. We're also finding that high school test to stay doesn't work as well with the high school, because quite frankly, we can't isolate the high school. What happens in grade three, if you have a positive COVID contact, you can isolate that grade three. They don't go to lunch, they don't travel to specials, they don't move around the building, and we do the rapid test, the antigen test, on the prescribed days, and that's how test to stay works. The problem with high school is because you've got 9th graders, 10th graders, 11th graders all in a particular classroom, it's very difficult to use test to stay. So in general, we're trying to get the PCR test done as quickly as we can, but we are quarantining those high school kids as cases come up. But I think, again, given the stress level and given the spike throughout Vermont, you know, it's just those reminders that masking, sanitizing, distancing is critical. And I'm going to, sorry about that spelling, but I'm going to send out an email. I think part of what happened over the weekend and last week in all three of our districts, you know, people are still just feeling free of the virus. And so we're having birthday parties and large gatherings, and it's just creating, some of the child cares are running into problems. So then that filters into the school. There's very little transmission in school because I think the masking and the distancing helps, but kids are bringing it into school. And consequently, the adults too are being very sensitive to their symptoms. We've had a couple of staff members in the last week or so test positive. So that's creating a little bit of havoc. And as the principals reported, it's everybody's having to cover for everybody. So it's just creating that level of stress. I think as we get vaccinated, you know, that's going to help. I gave out the numbers of those who did get vaccinated with the first dose. We also have a lot of kids who have gotten vaccinated privately through their own pediatrician or at other clinics. The second dose of vaccines are coming up in the next 2 weeks. So by after the holidays, we should have, I'm going to say, upwards to 50% of our K-5, K-6 population vaccinated. And already at our 7 through 12, we've exceeded 60%. I think we're getting closer to 70%. And I think that's going to help. But we've had a couple of breakthrough cases this week where that happened at the high school. We had a couple of vaccinated high school students who contracted and had positive cases of COVID. And I will say that probably many of our high school kids are getting close to where they're going to need boosters, right? I think that happened toward the end of the spring, and they're probably coming up on that booster time. So we're going to check that. We've got a great nurse at Windsor, Elizabeth, who is terribly overworked, but she's got some good support from the administration and her assistant and volunteers that help her when it comes to test to stay. But we're trying to stay on top of it, and we are collecting data about who's vaccinated and who's not. But that's what adds to the staff stress, as the principals reported. We do have that staff shortage I talked about last time at the SU meeting. I don't know if I did it at this meeting, but just in Mount Ascutney alone, we've had 9 resignations, all for different reasons. Some of them just getting other jobs, but also some of them just burnt out One, because they didn't want to get vaccinated, and we do have that vaccination mandate. We've got many positions unfilled, WSESU-wide, just in Mount Escutney, one special ed case manager, one BCBA, three PERMA subs, one school counselor, two interventionists, and six support staff. We've been advertising, but people just aren't out there taking the jobs. And we'll continue to advertise. We talked about some creative ways to advertise today, so we'll see what happens. But so that's, you know, and again, the ad team is pitching in, and they're also trying to develop plans to compensate for that workload for staff. But it's not always easy. We did take that end of the day period, which was we had a lot of things we were putting into that in terms of the initiatives and the strategic plan, but we've backed off of that for the month of December into January, so teachers can catch a breath at the end of the day. So we're trying to address that. First public forum, you all, we already talked about that, but Bill and Davis, thanks for pulling that off. And by the end of the night, I'm told that there was quite a turnout. And, you know, in terms of, you know, as turnouts go in these conditions, but hopefully we got some good takeaways. And as Davis said, that's one of at least three. I think we said we wanted to have three public forums this year that would all be topic centered and pace centered. So we'll just talk about the next one, you know, as January arrives here. Budget update, we're going to present the local budget tonight. I think we sent out the spreadsheet with the detail over the weekend or even before the weekend. But as always, the state numbers will trickle in this month. My mind just froze on me, but the amount per student but it's not exact yet, and we don't have the CLA yet, and we don't have some of the other numbers. So we probably will not be knowing the tax rate and probably adopting a final budget until our meeting in January, but we can certainly have some conversations tonight. SU budget is finalized, and you see the assessment in our budget. Negotiations, the teacher mediation will be on Wednesday, December 8th. Our negotiating team, made up of Jackie, Scott, and Bill, are ready to go. The EPS support staff will begin on December 15th. I think all this negotiating, and especially the teachers not having a contract, also adds to the stress level. And the negotiating team is aware of that. And I think they've got some pretty generous offers to make on Wednesday. And we're hoping we can close it out. We'll see what happens. But that clearly is adding to the stress. So we're cautiously optimistic, but that's kind of where we are right now. The Equity Task Force, we'll talk more about this later. We are going to meet with Melissa Crum next Monday to review the action steps that the task force created. The Lavelle Brown work is going on. Mary Gannon told me she will have a proposal for us in time for our SU meeting on Monday. She's going to be tackling two pieces of this. One is some board training for all of us. And also, she's going to, the hope is that she can help us facilitate the job description and parameters of the diversity, equity, and inclusion coordinator. And then Courtney Hillhouse is going to give us a presentation on some of the other disparities in our risk population. Equity is certainly not just about people of color, but there are a lot of other ways, especially in our area where we do experience a certain level of poverty, where we see inequity. And I think Courtney will speak to some of that as she presents here in just a second. So I think that's it for me now, unless anybody has any questions. I'll stop presenting and certainly answer questions if you have them. And sorry about the late notice on the delay this morning, but apparently, I mean, I got more. This is the first time I got actually email saying, I think it was a good call. I was nervous because we made the call late, but I think those back roads were pretty rough. Even in Windsor, we've got some pretty steep hills and back roads that were freezing up. And quite frankly, a little bit worried about tomorrow morning, although the temperatures are supposed to stay in the upper 30s. So we'll see what happens. That's it for me.
David, I don't know if you know this, but wearing my legislator hat, I just learned today that Mark Perot has left the Joint Fiscal Office. Did you know that?
Oh, really? No, I did not know that.
Yeah, he retired.
Okay.
Effective, I think it's already in effect.
Wow. So have they replaced him?
They've replaced him with three people.
I bet.
But they're not up to speed yet. So it might be, that is to say, it might be a little while before some of those numbers come out.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm worried about. And even with Brad James at the AOE, he is so overwhelmed. And he really is the linchpin for all of this financial information that comes out. I'm expecting, you're right, Elizabeth, that it'll be a little bit later.
Yeah, I was informed today that Brad James actually gets all of his numbers from Mark Perot. So,
well, that's good. That's good to know. So that makes sense. And they are both excellent at what they do.
Yeah.
You know, maybe the legislature, keeping your legislative hat on, maybe the legislature didn't they last year, I don't know whether they gave permission or whether they actually enforced moving town meetings to April or May. I don't remember how that worked, but this might be a good year to consider that again.
Well, that has been asked, but because the governor rescinded his emergency order, it's not possible. So, no.
Write letters to your governor. That's all I can say.
Write letters to the Secretary of State.
Yeah, exactly. Keep those letters coming. That really helped in some districts last year.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Are there any other questions? Okay. Take it away, Courtney. Thank you for being with us here tonight. I really appreciate it.
And Courtney, I'm going to share, right? Or are you going to share?
If you could share, that would be great. I don't want everyone to sit through my trying to navigate technical difficulties, so I appreciate it.
I will,
Courtney,
do that.
Could you please tell everybody what your title is?
Sure. So hi, everyone. My name is Courtney Hillhouse. I am the Community Outreach Specialist with Mount Ascutney Prevention Partnership, which is a part of the Community Health Department at Mount Ascutney Hospital and Health Center. Okay. So tonight I'm going to talk about some disparities in risk and protective factors, looking at the Windsor County Middle and High School YRBS data. And I'm expanding upon a presentation my colleague Alice Stewart gave on diversity, equity, and inclusion that we are working on within the Prevention Coalition. So I'm expanding on some data points, like I said, specific to youth in Windsor County around the health disparities. I'm sure some of you are familiar, or most of you are familiar with the YRBS, but for those of you who aren't, the YRBS is the Youth Risk Behavior Survey. It is in collaboration with the Center for Disease Control, which is done every 2 years with the middle and high school students throughout the state. The data tonight I'm looking at is around county level data. The SU around health disparities is not broken out. So this, again, will be Windsor County data. Next slide. Thank you. I do want to show you some of the SU level demographics for middle and high school students. So students at the middle school level who identify as students of color, 10% at the SU level, and 90% identify as white non-Hispanic. At the middle school level, 12% identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender, while 88% identify as heterosexual or cisgender. At the high school level, 6% identify as student of color, and 94% of white non-Hispanic students. And at the high school level, 16% identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender, and 84% as heterosexual or cisgender. Next slide, please. Thank you. So I want to go over real quick, before we get into some of the concerning trends, what risk factors are. So risk factors are defined as characteristics at the biological, psychological, family, community, or cultural level that precede and are associated with a higher likelihood of negative outcomes. So some examples of risk factors for youth could be not feeling safe at home or school, not having a trusted adult in their life, or not feeling valued. So before I get into some of this data, I do want to point out that the topics being covered are bullying, suicide, and substance use. So I know that this can be heavy data. I just want to point out that that's what we're going to be going over. So in the power, I can send out the PowerPoint too, because I don't see the percentages listed here. So I'll go over these real quick. But at the middle school level, in regards to violence and bullying, on the YRBS data, the question asks if the students did not go to school because they felt they would be unsafe at school or on their way to or from school in the past 30 days. So 7% of white non-Hispanic students and 7% of heterosexual cisgender students reported this. 12% of students of color reported this, and 20% of LGBT students reported this. In middle school reporting bullied in the last 30 days, there is 23% of white non-Hispanic students, 20% of heterosexual cisgender students reported this, 30% students of color, and 50% of LGBT students. And then at the middle school level, when they asked if they were ever electronically bullied, 23% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 22% heterosexual cisgender students, 33% students of color, and 50% of LGBT students reported this at the middle school level. So violence and bullying reported at the high school level, 7% of students that are white non-Hispanic did not go to school because they felt unsafe at school or on their way to or home from school in the past 30 days. 6% of heterosexual cisgender students, 11% students of color reported this, and 18% of LGBT students. When asked if they were bullied in the past 30 days, 17% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 15% of heterosexual cisgender students, 20% students of color reported this, and 33% of LGBT students. And then when asked if they were electronically bullied in the past year, we have 15% of white non-Hispanic students, 14% heterosexual cisgender students, 18% students of color, and 27% LGBT students. Okay, looking at mental health on the YRBS at the middle school level, the question of at the middle school have ever done something to purposely hurt themselves without wanting to die, such as cutting or burning themselves on purpose in the last year. So 19% of middle schoolers of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 16% heterosexual cisgender students, 26% students of color, and 52% of LGBT students. The question of ever seriously thought about killing themselves, 17% white non-Hispanic students reported this, 15% heterosexual cisgender students, 24% students of color, and 42% LGBT students. When asked if they ever made a plan about how they would kill themselves, 11% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 10% heterosexual cisgender students, 19% students of color, and 34% LGBT students. But then when asked if they had ever tried to kill themselves, 5% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 4% heterosexual cisgender, 11% students of color, and 19% LGBT students. Again, this is at the middle school level. Okay, next slide, please. Thank you. At the high school level, when asked if they did something to purposely hurt themselves without wanting to die in the past year, there are 17% reported of white non-Hispanic students, 13% heterosexual cisgender students, 22% students of color, and 43% LGBT students. When asked if they had made a plan about how they would attempt suicide within the past year, 12% reported this of white non-Hispanic students, 8% heterosexual cisgender students, 13% students of color, and 35% LGBT students. And then when asked if they had attempted suicide in the past year, 5% white non-Hispanic students reported this, 3% heterosexual cisgender students, 7% student of color, and 19% LGBT students reported this. So this slide shows substance use for LGBTQ plus students in the middle and high school level. You'll see that there's quite a few green arrows, which is great. That means that use is going down. I do want to point out where use is going up for middle and high school students around percentage of students who used cigarettes, cigars, smokeless tobacco, or electronic vapor products in the past 30 days. Okay, the next slide shows the YRBS indicators for students of color. This slide shows several red arrows where use is increasing in students of color. And I do want to point out that there's a 300% increase of middle school students of color who binge drank in the past 30 days. So as you can see, a lot of times students of color, LGBT, are kind of put in the same category and they're having quite different experiences. So this is where they need to be separated out, especially when you're looking at these data points in particular. So what is one way to decrease those risk factors? By increasing protective factors. So protective factors are characteristics associated with a lower likelihood of negative outcomes or that reduce a risk factor's impact. So protective factors may be seen as positive countering events. Some of those protective factors could be having a place to feel safe, having a trusted adult in your life, and feeling valued. Next slide. Thank you. So this is where we want to see those percentages increase. So the higher the number, the better. When asked at the middle school level, if students have at least one teacher or other adult in their school that they can talk to if they have a problem, 75% of white non-Hispanic middle school students reported this, 76% heterosexual cisgender students, 69% of students of color, and 62% LGBT students reported this. The high school level, when asked if there was at least one teacher or adult in their school that they can talk to if they have a problem, 81% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 81% heterosexual cisgender students, 72% of students of color, and 74% LGBT students. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is where there's a little concerning data at that middle school level. And I want to point out, too, that community can be interpreted in different ways, so something to keep in mind. So when at the middle school level, when asked if they strongly agree or agree that in their community, they feel like they matter to people at the middle school level, 58% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 65% of heterosexual cisgender students, 55% students of color, and only 23% LGBT students strongly agree or agree that in their community, they feel like they matter to people. When asked that question at the high school level, 61% of white non-Hispanic students reported this, 64% heterosexual cisgender students, 55% students of color, and 45% LGBT students. So this slide shows the trends over the years. For middle school students, you can see that these are the numbers are decreasing. And I do want to point out that they didn't start breaking apart this data until 2017. But this is the dark blue line, if you can see, is students that they believe, overall students believe that they matter in their community. And then we have the lighter blue line of LGBTQ plus middle school students who believe that in their community, they feel like they matter to people. And the orange is students of color that believe in their community that they matter to people. And I see a question. This is the Windsor County data. The SU level data couldn't be broken apart with health disparities. So I just want to address that question in the chat. Okay, so here is where we have some good news at the high school level. You can see that within the students of color and LGBT students that percentage is increasing. So again, this is where students, high school students who believe that in their community, they feel like they matter to people. Okay, so as I wrap this up, I just want to point out that yes, there are some disturbing trends, but there is hope too. You know, we all as a community can think about what we're doing for students to feel that they're being valued, but especially with students with those disparities and how to decrease those risk factors. Some of the things that Mount Ascutney Prevention Partnership is doing, we like to call it the upstream prevention, where we're working with early child care centers, connecting to trainings where they're learning ways to be supportive of not only LGBTQ families, but the kiddos who are identifying at that young age, but how to put that support into practice. And so we're also working with the early child care centers around the training for the pyramid model for early multi-tiered systems of support and in-person coaching to really address ways that they can work with the social emotional learning at that really early age to hopefully you know, help with the later years as well. So I always like to point out too, nothing about us without us. So, you know, involving kiddos in any processes, if you know you're going to be having those conversations about next steps, you know, MAP's always a resource, but you know, kind of looking at what's being done now, are there any, you know, directions to go from here, you know, with particular on those disparities of the LGBT students and students of color. So I'm happy to take any questions or you know, offer any follow-up, but that's just the information I have right now. And I'm curious to see how COVID has affected this data with the 2021 YRBS. So thank you, everyone.
And Courtney, do you want me to put the presentation in the chat now, or do you want to clean that up with the percentages?
I can, with the PowerPoint, the percentages are there. I noticed with Google, it takes them out for some reason. I don't know why that is, but so if you have the actual PowerPoint, they should be there, but I can send it out as well.
I'll put it in the chat just so people Great. Have it.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for sharing that with us, Courtney. It's a lot of grist for the mill, as it were.
Right.
Rebecca, I see your hand.
Thank you, Courtney. That was quite informative. I do have a question. And my question is, so you've shared this information with whom in the community, and I'm just wondering if there's been an opportunity for it to be shared with parents in the community.
Yeah, that is a great point. I would love to share this with parents. So far, it's been shared with the JEDI, the Justice, Equity, Diversity, and Inclusion Committee, and my colleague Alice has shared it with the hospital service area. So, you know, happy to share it out with anyone else who's interested as well. But definitely, I think when you see those numbers cross comparison, it really is eye opening.
I think it also would help parents understand what's going on in the community with other students, other than information that they may be even getting from the school community. I think it's extremely important information that if it's possible to create a forum to get this information out to parents, it should be done.
Yes, absolutely. Thank you.
I have a question. What is the difference between that first group of non-Hispanic students and the second group of heterosexual cis students?
Right. So the heterosexual and cisgender students are what students are identifying as their gender and identity that matches with what they were assigned at birth. And white non-Hispanic is the white non-Hispanic identification.
What is the difference between those two?
So white and non-Hispanic would be, you know, your ethnicity, color, and the white, or the, heterosexual cisgender is what you're identifying as, both your identification and your gender, and if it matches what you were assigned at birth. So you're not identifying as what they've have as the, you know, LGBT. I believe the YRBS only asks LGBT, so lesbian, gay, lesbian, transgender, and bisexual.
Okay, it doesn't, for me, it looks like the people who are white would be in both groups, in both those first two groups. So do they pick one or the other?
Well, you can have students of, it depends on how they're identifying for themselves. So I don't know how they're, you know, but heterosexual and cisgender, you know, may not be identifying in other categories. I'm not sure how they're interpreting it. So, you know, it's a good question that I could, yeah, look into.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, go ahead.
Thanks. So my question was, how long has this data been compiled? And there was there any reason behind the thought process of sharing it with the other groups, but not the school?
As far as with the, well, the health disparities data that Alice Stewart presented at the HSA was just at the hospital service area, was for them to see the work that Mount Ascutney is doing. And then there was interest with someone in that meeting to see that data broken down. And that was where the, if we were invited to present at the JEDI meeting. And then from there, there was interest at the SU level. So that's kind of where the, you know, the direction of interest, but it's fairly new that we've been putting it, the data together. So, you know, kind of, I'm going where, you know, there's the invitation and, you know, if anyone has interest in seeing that data, I'm happy to share it.
Yeah, I guess I just made the assumption since we gave the survey out that we would be able, that we would get that information.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's, I know that we've been tracking it, you know, the YRBS when it comes out, but breaking it down specifically into kind of like the risk and protective factors and health disparities is fairly new for Mount Ascutney Prevention Partnership. So that's, yeah, definitely, you know, sharing it with the schools and any other interest in the, you know, the towns that we serve.
Thank you very much.
So just to be clear, that was for all of Windsor County, not for our supervisor union and not for your catchment area.
Right. That's, yeah, all of Windsor County data. I was curious, you know, why it's not broken down at the SU level, but because the numbers are so small, it's more, it can be easier to identify, which puts, you know, you don't want to have that coming into play. So there, yeah. So we just, the only SU level data that we've broken down is the demographics.
Okay, thank you. Angie, I see your hand.
I just wanted to say that for Nancy, it might be helpful to think about it as one question is your race or ethnicity for the whole group. And then another question is about your sexual identity. So it's a question for the whole group. So those first two columns were confusing because they were sitting together, but it's the whole group was asked. The same. Then you can compare it to the next two columns that talk about the students of color and then the LGBT.
Right.
Okay.
Right. So a student of color might be in the cis group, and which is why they're separated out.
Right.
Yes. Thank you, Angela. That definitely is a better explanation than it gets a little confusing when you're trying to break out the data points. And yeah, so I appreciate that.
Does anybody else have any questions or comments? Rebecca, I see your hand.
I had a question. Kate, this survey was done by in the schools? Okay. And the data was never shared with, the results were never shared with the school?
I mean, right now they were, and we appreciate that. But this sounds to me something like if we're gonna truly partnership that we should have had this data and like perhaps a conversation about it, because these are important things to us. And it's funny because I saw the data, I was pumped because no one leaves our offices without being asked who's one person in the school you can identify as your person. And if they can't, we call home and say like, hey, this is their assignment to come up with one person. It could be anyone in the building. It could be a para from second grade. Like, we will make time for that connection. So definitely a strong interest in this data and further conversation. And I know our school counselors who proctored the survey would also be interested in it.
Okay, I have a quick question. How are the schools, how is the data shared with the schools? Like once the YRBS, like county and SU level data, is that?
I don't know, Courtney. I'm gonna assume that this is all of our first go around with it. So we're working out the kinks together. Kylie might be able to answer that.
I think they put out just their annual report and all schools get it kind of at the same time.
Yeah, remember too, this is 2019 data, right? So.
Yep, exactly.
You know, my sense is that's what happens. It goes out to the schools. It would have gone out probably toward the end of 2019. And I don't know whether it goes to the school counselors or whether it goes to the principals or, you know, I mean, Kate, you know, this is your first full year, so you might not have been.
Yeah, so it sounds like it just got lost in the shuffle of changes here.
Let's see. I've got two questions from Annalise Ennis. One is, wait a minute, was this when the parents had issue with their children filling this out? And the second is, do you foresee the numbers increasing?
The answer to the first one, Elizabeth, is no. This is a different survey than the one that was so common.
That was a noise survey, right?
That was a different organization, different group. I think our kids and our families are pretty used to the YRSP, so they don't, you know, there doesn't seem to be too much controversy about it. We use a passive permission form. What was the second question, Elizabeth?
Do you foresee these increasing?
Well, I think again, I'm not a prophet, but I would say that the stress level, given the pandemic, is certainly putting a lot of pressure. The isolation, the trauma, the stress, some of the stuff that kids are finding and feeling at home, all the stuff the principals talked about at the beginning of this meeting. I'd be surprised if the 2021 data doesn't show an increase or a spike.
Bill, you have a question?
Yeah, is there any plans or to include some socioeconomic risk factors in this survey? Or is there a different tool that the state may use?
That's a great question. And I don't know how at the state level they break that out or what the process is for adding, like including that in, but that's something I can look into and to see like kind of, I know that, you know, with a lot of things, it takes a lot of time. So, you know, especially with the YRBS getting the results, you know, comes out the state level, then you get the county level and the SU, and it could be by that point, you know, how relevant is the data to current trends? But having the socioeconomic, you know, data points broken out, I would be interested in that as well.
And plus,
so I can look into that.
These categories are all self-identified, and I bet you it would be hard for a student to self-identify. You know, I never realized I was poor when I was in school. I thought I was doing pretty well, but you have to self-identify in that category. So that might be the real trick there, if you know what I mean.
Well, it could be the fact that it would be an interesting data point to see their perception of their self-identification.
That's a good point. Yeah.
I'm starting a study at Hartford regarding socioeconomic based upon a couple factors, one being home value.
Yeah.
Avis?
Yeah, thank you, Courtney, for sharing that data with us. And I think you know, clearly based on the conversations we're having, the interest in seeing this breakout, that may be something we can do going forward to kind of keep an eye on on those trends, especially you know, with some of the negative impacts that we've seen on our students during COVID. I'd be interested in hearing more of what you have to say about opportunities for, you know, for MAP or for other community groups to help work with the school to maybe address some of these issues outside of the building and in partnership with the community. I know that that can play a pretty huge role in supporting students who may, you know, have difficulties in a school setting as much as the school is able to do. So I'd just be interested to hear what you got to say about that.
Yeah, so thanks, Davis. Some of what we've heard just with, you know, connecting with other school folks is, you know, because of COVID and trying to kind of get into that caught up space, they're seeing a decrease. I don't know if this is happening at this SU level. This is with a different SU, but a decrease in those activity times. So when the Gay Straight Alliances or other similar groups could meet before, now that time is cut and they're kind of struggling with keeping academics as well as those other outside supports, you know, in their activities or, you know, other things going on. One thing that's been in conversation, and this is always a tricky one, is having, you know, a space, like a safe space for like teens, especially, you know, at the community level. So not specific to being embedded in the school, but like, you know, if there's something within the town where kids can kind of just go hang out, you know, build that sense of trust and community amongst one another. That's something that's I've heard in discussion throughout the years, but finding like the logistics of that is always a complicated thing to navigate. So that's something I would love to see, but making that happen is, you know, a little bit more cumbersome. So that's, but I would love to have, I mean, I know there used to be a space, but in Windsor, but just having that outside of school connection as well. And then having, so really having the safe space, because sometimes school is the only safe space, sometimes home is not, but also having that, you know, this place outside of school too would be something I would love to see. But just having maybe conversations of, are there other ways to do that that's not so up here, and that you can kind of get to that connection and building relationships, especially among peers, in smaller, more tangible ways. So I'd love to have those conversations and make it something actionable is always a goal. So I'm happy to join in if any of that or be a resource, you know, for MAP.
Sure. Yeah. And I imagine that being a longer conversation and, you know, again, being still in the COVID pandemic, conceptualizing of these physical spaces outside of school is pretty hard to do. But, you know, maybe in this kind of gap and opportunity to do that, you can do some brainstorming. I know that since I've been a student here, there have been multiple youth centers that have popped up and gone down, and, you know, the library or the pool room, the Pizza Chef, like things kind of come together organically. But if there are ways that we can intentionally support some of these spaces, it'd be a conversation I'd love to have. Thanks.
Yep. I just want to point out too that Outright Vermont has like a virtual statewide. I'm not sure if they're considering it not so much a GSA, but an area where kids can connect virtually, which is kind of one of the benefits of having this virtual platform, is that it kind of casts a wider net. So throughout the state, they can meet, and I can always send out a link if anyone wants to share it with students, but that's something that's going on too.
Angie?
I just wanted to say the YRBS is administered in the fall. So in the fall of 2019, these results were obtained. The process is very, the school counselors go into the classrooms, they have a manila envelope that they, well, this is how they used to do it when it was paper-based. It's probably all on computer now. So that's a moot point. So anyway, the results were released in March of 2020. So, you know, I know that the principal, that Ms. Riley, received those results. And I do know in the past, there was always a process where those results were reviewed in the school counselors. I just think that it got lost in the shuffle. Was the YRBS administered in October, Kate? Yeah.
Yes, it was.
for 2021. So
yeah, we just had it this past fall.
Right. So then we'll have those results hopefully March, April, May in the springtime. So we'll be looking for them then. Our social emotional screener that is starting this week, some of those similar questions are on there. So like, can you identify an adult in the building that you feel you could go to with a problem? That's a really key support for our students. So I'm looking forward to seeing what those results are.
Rebecca, I see your hand.
One of the things that Davis mentioned, and I would agree with, is that look to the schools to provide a lot of these supports is just not fair. And in the past, the community has had some youth center. They have come and gone. But I wonder, I know that the Mount of Scutney or the organization that you work with is always looking for ways to try and work with the community. And although this may not be a great time for to promote those relationships between businesses, I wonder though if there can be, and Davis had mentioned that brainstorming, that conversation that you can have now. So at the point that there is relief and that opens up an opportunity for, even if it's one or two businesses in the community, to say, we're ready, we've been talking about this, and you know, let's move in this direction, as opposed to waiting for the time when we're going to be able to just jump into this type of activity. But I think that it really is going to be important for us not to rely on the schools to, nor is it fair to rely on the schools to provide to assist in helping our youth and parents and families really grow in a more healthier direction. But I know that Mount of Scutney is always looking for ways, how can we intervene? So I hope there is more conversation on that.
Yeah, absolutely. I would love to have more conversation around that, especially with one of the data points is about community. So it's not, like, I agree. I definitely don't think it should fall on the schools, and where can we build that community support level and ways to work with that? Yeah, definitely. I'd be very interested in having follow-up conversations and brainstorms around this.
Excellent. Does anybody else have any questions or comments about it? Reflections? David, you look like you're about to say something.
Oh, I just wanted to, I'm sure you're going to do this, but I wanted to thank Courtney and Mount of Scutney. The hospital has formed such an incredible partnership in this community, and that whole partnership, along with Jill Ward and the whole company of folks, Courtney, both Courtneys actually, Courtney McCabe and Courtney Loves, have just been great partners. And I think COVID has put a dent in some of that, but I know the intent is to be there and to keep, you know, keep working together on all of these issues. And I think this is the first district I've worked in where there was such a community partnership. It's a good partnership.
Okay. I'll follow up with that. But I just want to say thank you for allowing me to present this data and offering some great suggestions and follow up. It's definitely a great collaboration and partnership with the schools. We really appreciate that and the community as well.
Thank you so much for being with us, Courtney.
Thanks, Courtney.
Thank you.
Now, Courtney, I think in our on our agenda was lumped in with the JEDI report and the anti-racism report. And Rebecca was the one who graciously attended the last
Jedi meeting in my stead. Rebecca, can you tell us how that meeting went and what the content was?
Yes, I can. Thank you, Elizabeth. the agenda on the Jedi committee started with a presentation by Carmina. I didn't get her last name. She is based out of Springfield. She spoke to the group around the 211 program, which sounds like an amazing program. And what it is apparently it's a database, and it's in Vermont, and apparently other states also have it. And it's 24/7. The database has information around education, housing, food insecurity, you name it, it has it. And it zeroes in not only on the issue, but it is zeroes in on where you can receive assistance in your particular community. The presentation was really great. They also have like 211 translators. It's an extensive database. They can run reports for grants. I think that at some point it would really be great to have them come in and maybe do a presentation to the board, because what they offer is not only for schools, but it's information that's available that would be great for students, high school students, as they are moving on and trying to access information on jobs, employment, education. This database has all of that information. It's a great tool for teachers, also to be able to utilize. It's free, they have a specific program which is called Help Me Grow, and it's on children and families. Courtney, you may know about it, but it just seemed so extensive that I thought we really, not only as a school community, but parents that are online and other stakeholders in the community can really benefit from just knowing about this program and knowing that they can access it at any time they want. Another thing that they discussed was the idea of having a student on their committee. And apparently, I don't know exactly who, but one or two individuals from the Jedi committee has met with some teachers and students. And they've come to understand that this is a bigger thing than they thought it was. And so they have really appreciated the conversations with the school and realized that this is a big responsibility. They're trying to look at how do they support a student? Should it be one student? Should it be two students? But the conversation continues. And so they, at some point, I don't know, but Elizabeth, you may have invited them to our school board. And at that point, hopefully they will share a little bit about that. They also talked about some best practices that they are looking at exploring. One of them is using pronouns. Apparently they just started having the conversation. And they also talked about a declaration of inclusion. I just found it extremely valuable. Listening and being part of the conversation that they're having regarding the town, and looking forward to them coming on the school board and talking a little bit more about what is it that they're doing.
Thank you so much, Rebecca.
You're welcome.
I think as far as the racial equity task force, as David mentioned, we have a meeting with Melissa Krem coming up, and we hope to get the nail down the job description for a DEI coordinator or JEDI coordinator. Some people like to say, the J is so often left off, J being justice. I believe the next part of our agenda is, does anybody have any questions or comments about any of that? I don't see any. So the next part of our agenda is the budget.
Yeah, so I'll just kick it off here and then I'll turn it over to probably to Jennifer, but the three administrators have been working with Ed Connors in the business office to try to put together the first draft of the budget. And we did it in three forms, really. One form, because you asked for that, was to just status quo and just moving everything from this year over to next year. And what would that create for an increase? And we can certainly tell you what that would be. And then we did what it would take to bring the district up to what we feel is capacity. And that would include keeping all the ESSER positions, whether we can have ESSER reimburse them or not. We just think that's important. But I think one of the things you'll hear from the principals, given what you've heard all night tonight, is that, you know, the stress levels, the social emotional needs, the academic needs, and what we thought was going to be a recovery year, and it's not a recovery year. So consequently, we wanted to build capacity in this budget, FY23, to be able to do that. And then we have a third scenario, which is really not much of a change, but Jen will explain that. That's really just how we might look at Albert Bridge and nothing major, but I think Jen can outline that for us. So you should have the detailed budget. I can certainly put it back in the comments section. But Jen, are you going to share your PowerPoint? Or okay, so I'm going to turn it over to Jen, and she'll walk you through. And we'll share the PowerPoint afterwards too. So you've got it.
All right, everybody, hear me okay?
Yes.
Perfect. Hey, can you see the screen?
Yes, we can.
Perfect. Okay, so we're going to try and run through this. I want to be mindful of time. I know my two colleagues from Windsor have been on the phone all weekend dealing with COVID stuff, so they haven't had a break, and we're all supposed to be at school bright and shiny first thing in the morning. So I'll do my best to be clear but concise. So we're looking at the budget for next year in our proposals, and the primary goal, as we know, is the alignment with the strategic plan, continuous improvement plan, and educational quality standards. So that includes for us meeting the needs of our students through lots of variety and flexible approaches to learning, including curriculum expectations in the core content areas of math, ELA, the civics and science, as well as additional areas of health, social, emotional, physical education, arts, language, culture, those kinds of things. We want to continue to invest in project-based, place-based, interdisciplinary work. We know that when we learn in a way that is connected, it makes more sense for our students and is more engaging. We're looking at building towards a makerspace in Windsor, which is similar to the same kind of idea as place-based that we have going in West Windsor, and offer engaging experiences for all learners. That includes our educators, our professional educators, so that we can excel and extend beyond the classroom. So we have three major goals within our strategic plan. The first one is student success and engagement. To address that, we're looking at things like Leader in Me, comprehensive assessment plans, co-teaching, interdisciplinary, student-driven learning, UDL, those kinds of things all lead towards student success and engagement. We know that when students are engaged, they are much more likely to learn in a way that is meaningful and sticks with them. Our second goal is culture and student wellness. We're looking at things like student advisory boards in the long range. We're trying to figure out where that fits in terms of our current status and how we can introduce those in more effective ways. Our diversity and equity work, and our restorative approaches, including our trauma-informed, collaborative problem-solving, and reflective practices. We're looking at the large ideas of the MTSS process, which is a systematic and comprehensive approach, which includes high-quality instruction, effective collaboration, expertise, comprehensive assessments, and is encompassed by a culture of continuous improvement, as well as decision-making for equity and excellence. Our health and wellness team, our mental health services, child nutrition, which currently is at no cost to families, and looking at how we think about school schedules are things that we put into our minds when we created this plan. And our third goal is information communication, making sure that we are engaging the community through regular updates, websites, data dashboard, which is coming soon, we hope, community events, as well as Leader in Me. So our general budget topics, let's see if I can make this happen. So we want to talk a little bit about some administrative structures. Last year, we put this in place, and we'll talk a little bit more about that with the three of us trying to run the ship. We'll talk about what's working, what's not. Looking at creating capacity, social, emotionally, as well as academically. Some great structures, particularly when we think about the middle school model, our strategic plan, including our Leader in Me approach to meet the portrait of graduate goals, trauma transforming system, as well as meeting the needs of our learning community throughout the pandemic. So we're looking administratively at the whole system, and at Windsor, the current thinking is that it would be incredibly beneficial for the school to have three full-time administrators who focus on key areas. So for this would be a K through five focus, so an elementary specialist, an administrator who has specific middle school interests, skills, and background, who can really be there for that unusual and creative developmental stage of the young mind and body, and then somebody who's specifically skilled at the high school level for the 9-12 stuff. And then out of this, we're looking at two options. One is looking at a 0.6 principal, which might be connected with a 0.4 position in the building, or as we are now, which is a full-time principal. So when we look at building capacity, we are looking at a few things. So at Windsor, the social emotional interventionist has become a critical component of our systems overall. We didn't start this work till maybe, I want to say, 6 years ago when we started trying to introduce emotional interventionists. And we're finding that when we get skilled staff in there who can be incredibly flexible for all students, it's really powerful. So we're looking at Windsor to have one at the elementary level, one at the middle level, and one at the high school level. And that would be an increase of one social emotional interventionist to the budget compared to where it is currently. We're looking at for general education support staff primarily to help with the K and first graders, kindergartners and first graders. There's a whole lot of needs there in general, just because developmentally they have so, they're young and they need a lot of support. So we're looking at a point or a four staff, so a 4.0 increase. We're looking at asking for an increase in the counseling position. So one at the elementary level, which we already have, one at the middle school level, which is not clearly defined. It's kind of a shared position. But again, going to the middle school model where it's a unique stage of development and relationships are critical during that stage, to have a counselor who is primarily focused and available for those students is something that we believe is incredibly important. And then continue with the two high school counselors that we currently have. Looking at to increase the academic interventionist at the K through three level to one full-time position. And this is to meet the needs of those youngest students. We know that earlier interventions certainly have payoff in the long run. At Albert Bridge, we are looking to put back in the 0.4 full-time multi-age academic teacher for Albert Bridge. So that's because we have two classes that have two grades in each. So that's one teacher teaching 8 core subjects. So we would like to put back in what we used to have, which is a 0.4 position. And it may be combined with the 0.6 admin position if that is something we go for. Then a 0.4 librarian position. So we did have 10 hours, and the librarian who was with us did feel like that was not enough time to do the work that was needed. So we would increase it by 5 hours, making it a 0.4 librarian position. A 0.4 art position. Currently we have 0.2, so it's just increasing it by a day to support the interdisciplinary work. So one day would be the art specific content areas, and the second day would just be to support interdisciplinary work. And then across the district, we have 2 positions that we'd like to think about. One is a school-to-home coordinator who has some background in social work. We are finding that a lot of our needs are, as Courtney mentioned, it's not just a family or a school thing, but it's a both thing. So can we find some supports? We have somebody in the district who works in this position, but is well overworked and needs a lot more support. So if we had somebody specifically for our district, we believe that'd be really powerful, because we know, again, it's about relationships that you build over time. And then increasing our BCBA position by 1, so that we can help support the behavior approaches that we are trying to introduce and develop. So we'd like to talk about some of the areas that we want to continue sharing in. The MTSS positions across both districts can provide a lot of support for each other and some innovation. We also have some good collaboration going along with the central office team with Angie and Brittany, as well as Katie and Sarah. And one of the challenges we're facing right now is that everybody's so overloaded that it's hard to find the time. But we do believe that as we move forward and things settle, we will find more time for the MTSS positions to share their work, as well as our social emotional teams. We know that when we can work together, in this, it will benefit all. So as we move forward, just looking at ways that we can really do some more collaboration. We tried a little bit, but as you know, things get pulled when we're highly stressed. So people are focusing on the groups that they know most, and it doesn't provide a lot of reflection and growth time in that way. And certainly sharing a home to school coordinator for both schools. Okay, so the numbers, let's get into the numbers. Sorry about the bouncing around. So the SU assessment, which those of you who have been on the SU meetings will know, our budget for last year through the SU, which the majority of it happens to be special education needs, was $2,953,326. This year's budget, which I believe was already approved, was $3,140,194. For the proposal that we're looking at, when I go through the FY23 budget, all these numbers that we see are the recommendation that we have for, let me see if I can find it, building capacity. So it's really about this slide right here of building capacity. So all of the numbers that you're going to see up front is going to be about this building of capacity. So it's adding these positions into our district as we're moving forward. At the end, I'll talk about some other options and the bottom line numbers that we can look at. So when we're looking at wages, the total number from last year is $5,198,588. This year it's $6,190,775. Some of that is just increase in the wages percentages as we increase over time. Others is additional positions. Benefits also increase. Some of that has to do with a 5-point-something% increase for health insurance and those kinds of things. But last year's budget was $1,879,908. This year, for FY23, we're proposing $2,236,179. Contract services, and these are just a bunch of numbers, so bear with me if you're not a numbers person. For FY22, this year we budgeted $206,984. And just so you notice, FY21 budget was significantly higher. That's because we're trying to put, I think, more stuff into our system rather than hire more outside. So when we talk about those social emotional positions, we're looking to shift some of that energy. So our current proposal for the contracted services is $354,185. Maintenance and repair, we're looking to change from $142,424 up to $152,059. In transportation, again, an increase of $105,000 to $157,138. Communication, insurance, and postage is up a little bit, $91,750 to $95,705. Then travel, a bit of a decrease here, $27,500 to $22,000. Supplies, textbooks, we went from budget, FY22 budget of $198,670 to $190,580. It's a slight decrease there. Energy is projected to be up a little bit from $258,000 to $655,000 to $279,633. Equipment. And Albert Bridge isn't listed here. You'll know some of these have some differences, nor does Mount Scutney, because usually the equipments get shared. So if something is bought for, let's say, Windsor High School or State Street, they can often bring it over to Albert Bridge to use. And things like Mount Scutney School District doesn't really need equipment because it's not a building. It doesn't have a building to maintain. So that budget is $38,400, going down a little bit to $37,925. Dues and fees also down $19,200, down to $17,815. High school tuition, so the top one, Mount Scutney School District wide, is what we paid because since before we merged and we grandfathered certain grades to be tuitioned out. So that decreases each year until we get to the point where we're no longer tuitioning anybody out. So if my calculations are correct, this is 10th, 11th, and 12th graders now that are being tuitioned out. And so in 3 years, that should go away. The Windsor High School tuition, $15,000. And if I recall correctly, that is to Family Place. Oh, and that's a picture of the Windsor High School football team at state champions, which they won. Just want to point that out. Okay. Debt services. So West Windsor came in with a debt, and it, I want to say, ends in 2025. I think Ed can give us more specifics than that. And the Mount Scutney wide. Debt services, he can also fill us in if we have questions. So here's the general fund FY22 budget, which is the year we are in, was $11,744,125. The status quo, which is we don't change, add anything to our budget. Everything is as it's going to be, just the increase of you know, standard raises and insurance costs is increases it to $12,194.81. The scenario that I walked you all through, which is the building capacity scenario, brings us to $13,452,593. In the scenario two, this is where we're looking at a possible option of what I mentioned, a 0.6 principal, and the other component would be a 0.6 school counselor. And this is just reflecting the fact that schools the size of Albert Bridge do not typically have a full-time counselor or a full-time principal. In fact, a full-time counselor is supposed to be recommended for 300 students. So it's knocking both of those positions back from full-time to 0.6 positions. And that would come to $13,364,259, which the percentages look like this. So an increase of status quo would be 3.38%. The scenario that we presented with meeting capacity is 14.55%. And then the slightly reduced meet standards of principalship and school counseling for the numbers of ABS would be at 13.8%. A lot of numbers. Here's some ideas that came from the board that I wanted to not let us drop, but I wasn't quite sure where to put them or what to do with them. So one was looking at creating some flexibility in transportation. So I did some research, and these are some highly rated options. So you could get a 12 to 15 seat passenger van. My understanding, as I was told, is that while that's typically okay for most people in schools, you're not allowed to drive them without a license, specifically a bus license. At 15, but you can drive a 10-seater. So this one over here is an 8-seater, which is close I could find to a 10-seater in the highly recommended world. So that would be one van cost. Then another idea that came in was to get lights for the football field. And that was spec'd at $128,000, but it doesn't include conduit, which I think Larry could talk more about. And it's only one estimate, and it was not put out for any kind of bidding. Just an idea. Another idea that came through was this idea of amplification for the teacher so that a teacher's voice doesn't have to be raised to be heard, which we know in trauma-informed work can often set a kid off. So each one of those systems per classroom is 1,562. And then the other idea that I held on to was bonuses for staff. So it might be like a retention bonus. So those of you who made it through the entire year might get, for example, $1,000 per staff. So just ideas that were brought up that I didn't know where to put or what to do with, but I didn't want to lose sight of them because I think they're all interesting ideas and some really good ideas. Last one was giving back to the community, so sending back some of the funds to offset taxes for the taxpayers. Also not in the budget now. Okay. Well, that was a lot of numbers. What questions do you have for us? Davis, you want to jump right in there?
You might need to get you, to, you're muted, Davis.
Oh, yeah, it'd be helpful, huh?
Good.
Yeah. One very simple question, just this came up early in your presentation, but you said makerspace versus place-based. I just wanted to make sure that my understanding of those terms is correct, because I think of makerspace as being a very specific thing that doesn't necessarily apply to a school. So
the idea, and I can certainly let Colleen or Kate talk a little bit about this, is that in a makerspace, it can follow a pretty wide continuum, but as I understand it, you can have something that's just embedded in the school, which is really a lot of engineering-based kind of work, and that can extend all the way to a community of experiences where people come in who are sort of the experts or the mentors, and other people in the community, so it doesn't even have to be embedded in the school, come to learn alongside. So it can certainly grow into a community of almost the old-fashioned apprenticeship approach, which is, I think, where they tend to want to go if you've got really good energy and support. But I do know that there's some specific ideas around that at Windsor that Kate or Colleen probably can talk a little bit more to.
Our librarian definitely would like to go down the path of more engineering concepts. She's partnered with the Heartland librarian in our high school, 7 through 12, our tech ed teacher, Mr. Day, does the robotics, the 3D printing, the CAD drawing, all those kinds of things she'd like to bring to the level of our K through 6 students. And she's done it in the past. Our library was closed last year. We didn't get that opportunity last year, and she'd like to bring it back as she works alongside our Heartland librarian, and they kind of support each other in makerspace engineering programming.
Cool. Yeah, I am familiar with the Claremont makerspace a little bit. I know that's been a really great benefit to their community. So it's great to hear that in the context of getting our kids in there and also tying some of the community in. So thanks for that. And then could you say a little bit more about the Red Cat idea? I know that was just kind of a little tag on at the end, but I've seen those systems in place and they can be really beneficial. Would it be all of the classrooms, like a segment of them, or is that not really?
So I've given a lot of thought to this. It's not very practical to do it for all classrooms. That's a pretty hefty price tag, but Bill Gates, I think you may have some experience with this, if you don't mind just kind of sharing how that works in your experience.
Yeah, we're looking at the Hartford is, we've had it at Hartford about 10 years now, and they're beginning to wear out, of course, and we're looking at replacing costs. It's pretty hefty. We're looking at, I can't remember the number, but the price tag was like $210,000. The best thing to do is to visit a school like Dothan, and I've been in there, and they use one there that is portable as well, that goes out to PE, and it's a very powerful tool in which, for example, I showed Elizabeth one day the fourth grade classroom, which is actually two classroom co-teaching, and when you have those two classrooms, in which is a huge open space, you can teach that entire space with that verbal ability. And so most of the elementary classrooms have them. And it feeds into the fact that there are students with hearing needs, and that system automatically ties into those hearing needs.
Thanks.
I think Katie is probably planning on adding a little bit to that.
Yeah, go ahead. So I'm glad you brought up Dothenburg. That's actually where I knew it from too. And I was a support staff there years and years ago, and I just remember how helpful it was for a lot of the students I worked with. So that's a really good implementation. I think that was when it was pretty new, actually. I was there, so.
When I was teaching at Dothenburg, I had a third grade classroom in particular with the light speed system. No students identified that needed it. All what you consider regular students. Every morning, if I didn't put it on, a kid would bring it up to me and hand it to me. The clarity, how kids could hear from wherever they were in the room, they're amazing. And I'm not a quiet teacher, quiet spoken person, so it wasn't that. Once they get used, students get used to it, they really like it, and they miss it when it's not there. So that's from, classroom teacher experience too.
I just want to make three quick points. These will be really quick. Ed Connors is on the line, so if there are any specific questions about some of those line items that Jennifer went over, he tells me his lights are flickering and that who knows what's happening. I know we just got a real hail of rain. So if there are any specifics, please feel free to do that. Keep in mind, number two, that this budget is built around the need for capacity during a recovery period and also an increase in enrollment. Windsor, I think Larry told me, and I think we mentioned this before, Windsor as a building is at its highest enrollment since 2007. So that's a pretty good increase. And I know just in the 10 years I've been here, I've seen that increase every year, but especially now that we are working, very closely as a district, and those West Windsor kids are coming to us, we're going to just see that increase. And then last but not least, we heard it tonight from Courtney Hillhouse, just those social emotional needs. And we do try to share throughout the supervisory union, but quite frankly, Mount Escutney as a district, when you put Albert Bridge and we are bigger than the other two schools combined. So trying to build those resources internally are critical. We can share between buildings when it seems appropriate, but not always do I think we get the SU services that are limited at best in those. I'm not talking about special education. I'm talking about things like homeschool coordinators, additional clinical services. So I think, that's got to be remembered. Last but not least, I know I said three, but I'm going to say four. It's hard really to understand the budget because you don't have all of the tax information. As Ed would tell you, we don't get it until the end of this month. So again, we can look at those three scenarios. They look like big increases, but when we factor in what you want to do with the surplus, and I think Ed told me, we had told you earlier that we had about between $900 and $1 million surplus. But we have since had a complete audit, and Ed told me the other day that the surplus is probably more like $1.2 million. Ed would have the exact number. But that's money that, again, you've talked about giving back to the taxpayers in some sort of tax relief, which could be put toward on the revenue side of the budget, and that would help to contain taxes if, in fact, we wanted to build some of these resources. That's it for me. Good job, Jennifer, by the way.
Hi, Rebecca.
Hey, Jennifer, I thought that was just great. I thought it was very clear, and I'm one of those people that are not good with numbers, but I thought you really helped me understand it. But I do have some questions, a former social worker myself, I'm very much for hiring more social workers and home coordinators, and I think that's really important. But I do, from what I understand, Katie, in her budget in special education this past year, has included more individuals with a background in behavioral expertise. And also, if I'm not mistaken, we at some point were relying on HCRS for their clinical services, but then instead of continuing to do that, we hired our own social worker. That said, and I know that at our board meeting we had asked, will these professionals be available to all of the students in the supervisory union? And we were told yes, they would. I mean, they would definitely first go to those students in special education, those students that were in need, but they would be available. And I think that was the move that Katie was trying to do. It was trying to create this an environment where all students would be able to access these services. I'm just wondering I know we want to build capacity, but I'm wondering if we do need to hire the additional social worker. I'm wondering if the coordinator is someone that definitely is a valuable piece, because that would be that connection between the parent and the school, which I think is so, so important. So I'm just trying to figure, okay, we've hired some people that are going to be doing this work, and we're going to hire more, but we don't really know how the people that we've hired to do this work, how that's going to play itself out. So I'm not saying don't go in that direction. I just have these questions. How is this going to play out?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question, Rebecca. And I think when I look back on this year, I think it's a good sort of barometer as to how it works when we're talking about the work that Katie does, which is remarkable work. I'm trying to put in place all of these things and do some sharing, is that the sharing that is done doesn't necessarily allow us to support all students. if that makes sense. So the priority goes to those who have particular needs on an IEP, and then we can filter down into some kids who are not specifically listed on a individual education plan. And so I know for us, for example, we have HCRS in our building, and they can see some kids who are not on a plan, but we've got a whole host of kids that need somebody, and they've got nobody. And we can't, right? So we can't put them on the caseload that's already there because that person's already tapped out. And so what we need to do is create capacity for all those students, because right now what we're seeing is not just a few kids outside of those who have met the needs for a 504 and IEP plan, but we're seeing a whole host of kids who normally probably would not need so much intense supports, but because of the chronic stress that is going on, they need supports. And so what we're looking at is really trying to make sure we've got what we need to support those kids, regardless of their plan. And so that's how I'm looking at it now. I don't know, Kate, Colleen, either of you have anything you want to add to that?
I was just going to say that we used to work a little in the past, a little bit more separately in special education and regular education. And now we work very well with Katie and our special education team. And we're always looking for ways to share resources, even when it is not noted that it has to be a student with an IEP. So we're always working to share.
Thank you. Okay, Annalise. Oh, sorry. Go ahead, Rebecca.
Okay. But I did also have one more question, and that was around the counselors' positions. So are you saying that there's one counselor for elementary students, and when you say elementary, that's K through five?
That's a part of the discussion. That's the current best thinking on it for the team, as I understand it, is that K-5 would be the elementary, 6-8 would be the middle school model that the SU is kind of seeming to settle on. I don't think it's fully settled yet. I don't know. And then 9-12 would be the high school.
Okay. And so you only have one counselor right now for middle school and one counselor for high school?
Currently, we have two who kind of do the middle and high school together. And that leaves, and then we've got somebody who specializes in the elementary level at Windsor. And so what that leaves is sort of our middle school team, which has this really unique group of kiddos kind of in limbo. They're like in between these two groups. And so they really need somebody who can latch into that developmental process and be there for them.
I understand that completely. I know that middle school students should have their own counselor, so you don't even have to sell me on that. I was just trying to get clarification on who's working with whom in this process. Thank you.
Thank you. Annalise, then Katie?
Yeah, I also just wanted to point out is that and if for any of you don't know, I work as a social emotional interventionist over at Albert Bridge, but when it comes to the HCRS and then it comes to a school counselor, there's a difference of also getting parent consent versus not getting parent consent. And so we have some children who we would love to see HCRS, but the parents have not consented to it. So if you have a school counselor, though, they can still see the child. They just provide a different level of mental health help, but it's still a very we need it. So that's another thing to bear in mind when we're talking about adding counselors, is that they are able to be more part of the school community and help the students out on a more one-to-one basis versus HRS is a, you know, subcontractor. And so there's only a certain amount of things that they can do within our school just to begin with.
Thank you. Katie?
And just to follow up, Rebecca, a little bit on what you said, one of the things we've really struggled with this year is we're down two BCBAs. And where there's a level of we could have a bigger impact if we could find folks. So several of our positions that we've increased on one additional HCRS clinician, we'll be advertising for another using the special ed ARP ESSER fund. But our goal is to continue to share and continue to not duplicate our efforts, but streamline and do things smarter. The hiring aspect has really gotten in our way. So that's then, as Jennifer said very well, then we have to triage the students at first on plans and then others, on which we don't like having to do and having to make those hard decisions. Hope that helps.
Yeah, so I do want to say we do a great job of sharing. We just know that there are parameters that are outside of our system that we do our best to also honor and follow, which makes things sometimes a little complicated and more rigid than we'd like to be. Any other questions for us right now? Thank you all.
I'm not sure I understand why we are budgeting for a middle school model and we haven't even started the middle school model conversation yet.
Yeah, the SU has started the middle school conversation. Matter of fact, we're probably 6 or 7 months into it now with that middle school task force. if you're specifically talking about Elizabeth, whether or not the sixth grade at Albert Bridge or the fifth grade at Albert Bridge would be part of that middle school, that conversation has not started yet. But what we want to do is in our bigger buildings, we want to get clear on as a group of professionals on how we'd like to get our middle schools organized.
That is the deadline for that is what?
Well, we had hoped, there really is no hard, fast deadline, and quite frankly, how the middle school model rolls out won't impact the budgets in any of the buildings, quite frankly. So I don't feel we're under any budget pressure. We had hoped in this recovery year and with the ongoing task force work that we could have it completed by spring. I don't know if that's going to happen. We have not met since the last time this board met as a task force. So we meet again on Thursday. And we're going to be looking at some more data around numbers and kids and some of the research and talking about grade configurations in a little more depth. But there's no rush on that right now. That's what I was going to report under the middle level part of our agenda, that we've got some time to do this. And Bill, I saw your question. Yeah, the middle level task force right now is made up of all the middle level teachers, but right now, we're defining middle level as 5 through 8 for the purposes of the membership of that task force. And the administrators sit on that task force ad hoc. Patty Parmelo is the teacher rep who sort of facilitates and has led this, especially the last couple of months. I kicked it off last spring, and I'm staying very close to that group. But that's who's on that task force.
Does anybody else have any questions about the budget? We'll get to the middle school discussion in just a minute, Bill.
And I think what we should probably do, Elizabeth, on the budget, and you tell me what you think, but until we look at the impact of these scenarios on the tax rate, and of course the administrators have talked about, backup plans, should we not be able to take on all of this, or we can't allocate enough of the surplus to offset that tax rate. But I think by our first meeting in January, and I know the first Monday in January is a holiday, but I think we can take another look at this. What I didn't know, Elizabeth, was whether or not there were one or two board members who, much like we did at the SU level, who would want to be sort of a subcommittee that once those tax numbers come in, we could reach out to them and have some conversations about these scenarios. It's really up to how the board wants to proceed. We don't have to have a town report ready till the end of January.
Just very quickly, Jennifer, do you have any idea how much the total for the three ad hoc items might be?
I do not. And I think one of the, I've got a couple of questions to make that, and I can certainly do that. I think one of the things is, you know, how many vans would be one of them. Another would be needing to get some ideas on how many of those Red Cat, the voice enhancement systems we would want. And then the other one is, what would we talk about when we're talking about bonuses for staff or paying back staff? So those were things I would need more information to give an idea. I mean, I could create my own ideas, which is fine. I'm happy to do that, but didn't want to make that assumption.
Thank you. Bill, or Nancy, I see your hand, and then Bill.
Before we leave the budget, Jennifer, Craig talked to us about the cafeteria, and he had a couple of different scenarios. What scenario did you include when you had the slide for building improvements?
Nancy, I got to be completely frank with you. I have not met with Craig since October. I don't know what he put in.
Yeah, and I think, Nancy, I think what you're talking about is the cafeteria renovations that Larry discussed. And the proposal that Larry had was that that would come out of capital improvement monies, and it would not impact your local budget. So that there's nothing in this budget for those cafeteria improvements.
Looks like Bill's hand is up.
I think you're on mute, Bill.
Silly sec. I got two mute buttons going here. Not to get too deep into the water. Looking at want to respond to David's suggestion of getting a small group together. I think I would prefer to meet as a whole board and to discuss goals as the goals of what we want to accomplish rather than adjusting the goals to the money at this point. And one, I know we have a surplus. I would prefer to, for the board to have its own discussion on, to prioritize those ad hocs and to prioritize the goals before we actually just look at money. I think Jennifer put together a great presentation on, the impact of the different options. So I would rather do that sooner than later.
I think that's another way to go, Bill. I agree with you. And really what you're talking about to some degree is the bigger picture or the first few slides that Jennifer presented and how that then impacts the budget around how we're tying some of this to the strategic plan. There's nothing saying you can't have, I realize this is always the problem with the holidays coming up and stuff, but it doesn't mean you can't have, another meeting before that break, or you could have one in early January and one, you could do back-to-back meetings. I mean, the problem is you're always under that pressure because you don't have quite all the information you need from the state. But it's probably better, I agree with you, it's better to make those decisions apart from the tax impact. I mean, not that you don't have to think about that, but it's really, what are you trying to accomplish? I agree with you.
Right. And that's so before we even get the information from the state, I think it's good for us to, even in our next meeting, if we prioritize that, to look at what our goals are first. What are our priorities with the budget, and what are our priorities with the ad hocs? And then depending on how the taxes come in, how the state information comes in, we can always, if we set what our priorities are on the three options that Jennifer has laid out, once those are met, wherever we set our goal at, we can then adjust the ad hoc to fit the needs. That would be my preference. To goal one is to meet our goals that Jennifer has laid out, and what are the goals that the board wants to meet with adding capacity. After that, whatever is left over, what are our priorities for the ad hoc?
May I suggest that we, anybody who wants to be involved in that discussion can, not just pick one or two, but anybody who wants to can. So it lets off the hook anybody who doesn't want to.
I think that's a great suggestion. And of course, Elizabeth, as always, you can sign me up.
My preference would be to meet next week.
Yes.
Because I am going to have really limited time in the beginning of January. And I can't promise any additional meetings in the very beginning of January. But I could meet next week.
Okay, let's plan that.
It would be good to set a date, you know, even like right now, just so we're all on that same page. Not that everybody would have to come, but as Elizabeth said, if you wanted to, you could.
Well, and I would prefer to set it around the other school board responsibilities I have coming up, which is...
Yeah, there's quite a bit going on, and next week is an interesting week.
Well, we have the SU meeting on Monday. Is Tuesday a good day for anybody?
Tuesday is the Weathersfield board meeting, but that doesn't mean that that's the Weathersfield board meeting. I mean, the principals could meet with you. I think, you know, you're going to want some administrative presence there to answer questions.
I'm okay with Tuesday, seeing this is a board discussion. I think it would be great to have as many administrators who can come. But this meeting is more of a board forum to at least my perception, what I put forward, a board forum to come up with what our goals are and not necessarily make a decision, but to prioritize and put down on paper, this is what we want to do.
Yeah. And we also, Jennifer has some additional backup slides that could be looked at that night. I mean, we didn't get into all those slides just because, but it sounds like Jennifer can make Tuesday. How about Colleen or Kate? Can either one of you make Tuesday night?
We can right now, but like the way it's been going, who knows?
Yeah.
We're trying our best.
Good point. So what time do you want to set that for? Any
6:30 still works.
Want to stay with the 6:30?
Yeah, I would prefer.
Okay, good.
Get those ADHD 5-year-olds in bed.
Mine are right here. We haven't even left work yet. Can we make it one of our goals, which we're doing tonight, to stick to the time constraints? Because I have to say, yes, that is really helpful when we're in the situation we're in right now.
Yep. Yep.
So I really appreciate it.
But Jennifer, not to put additional work on you, but because I'm going to be with Weathersfield, do you want to send out that invite so you own the meeting?
I can do that.
Invite the board members and the three administrators, depending on Elizabeth, do you feel, I mean, I know it's a forum, but it sounds more like a board meeting with discussion. I don't know about decisions, but I assume we should warn that.
Yeah, I think it should be warned.
Okay, and we'll just, the only item will be budget.
Yeah, if we don't get a quorum, then we can just meet.
Yeah, that's fine. All right, so Jennifer will send out the invite, and then I'll have Lori warn it.
Okay, great. Anybody else have any questions or comments about the budget at this time? Okay, next item on our agenda is, what is it? Middle school.
Yeah, so as I said, I don't have a much of an update because, you know, with the holiday and we had to cancel one time because of COVID conditions, the middle school task force has not met again. I know this, I think I want to separate out the two issues here because I keep hearing about board member involvement and community involvement. And I mean, right now the discussions are internal because in three of our buildings, they include all of those grade configurations. I just don't want to confuse that discussion with the discussion about, you know, whether or not, if we, let's say we went 6-8, the sixth graders would come over from Albert Bridge, because there would be a way we could deliver a middle school program at Albert Bridge, if that's what the Albert Bridge community wanted to do, whether it was sixth grade or whether it was 5-6, if we went 5-8. I think that's a separate conversation, but maybe people can, you know, can discuss that if they want to right now.
Dr. Baker, would it be possible for me to be the admin representative and let Kate and Colleen go home and take care of themselves for a minute? They've been really busy for 3 days straight.
Yep, go home.
Take good notes, Kate and Colleen.
Thank you. I see
Bill.
Thank you.
Thank you for everything. Thank you for all that you do and your very, very hard work.
My son is waving goodbye. I'll put him on. There, go ahead, waving goodbye. Bye, thanks.
I think Bill has a hand up, Elizabeth.
So I guess I'm just going to start talking here. David, I think you're absolutely right to separate those two things out, because I have a couple concerns about the way the discussion has been going at the school board meetings. And there are been some, not necessarily red flags, but of slips of definitions. Okay. You know, first of all, I think it's a great discussion to move from a junior high setup, which my impression is that the middle school grades at Windsor has been functioning on some levels based upon a middle school because of it's scheduled very much been functioning as a junior high, because it's been functioning within the bell schedule of the high school, and it's been functioning at the prep period of the high school, and so that leads more when you schedule a middle school format like a high school, you're basically scheduling a junior high, but also scheduling also has it's just a very small piece of what makes the difference between a middle school and a junior high. It also has to do with, the support system in place, the educational mentality, a lot of different things. What it doesn't have to do with is grade level. The difference between a middle school format and a junior high format's got nothing to do with what grades are involved. Okay, and that's, and I think, David, you've misspoke a couple times based upon that, in that if you have a grade 7 and 8 middle school, that doesn't mean that it's a junior high because it's grade 7 and 8. You have a middle school 7 and 8. If you have a middle school 6, 7, and 8, then it's not because of those grade levels you're including, it's because that is the curriculum, the scheduling, and the support that you have created. I do think one thing I'm disappointed at is the fact that, you know, I don't think the board was, there's a couple things that have happened, and I won't get into them in tonight, in which the board really was, I had no idea that there was a discussion about shifting to a middle school format. because, you know, I had asked for several years ago to begin to have a group to discuss that. And we started it. We had one meeting, and then we didn't have one for a little while. And then COVID hit, and we stopped, and we haven't met since. The other thing I want to point out from my perspective is that grade levels and a shift that would include moving grades from one building to another would have to get the approval of this school board. I don't see any alternative to that. That would be something that would be a school board decision. That said, I have no problem with looking at the possibility of creating a grade 6 through 7, 8 middle school, especially if grade 6 has a different sort of format as grade 7 and 8. Because the middle schools I've worked in, and they have been middle schools, the sixth grade was oriented slightly different in consideration of that age level is the most particular, the most developmentally changes and involved. And the research is pretty clear that sixth graders that are solely within a grades that are within a middle school format function lower than sixth graders that are in elementary format. And I don't think that really has to deter moving them to a middle school format, but you have to consider that when you look at the supports that sixth graders require are much different than what a fifth grader or fourth grader require, and it's much different than what a seventh grader and an eighth grader require. So that's I'll be quiet and let other people chime in, but I thought it was important for me to point out that couple points. And David, I really like the way that you pointed out that those are really two different discussions. Grade levels at which schools and the actual work that this committee is doing.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that feedback, Bill. And I'm sorry if I misspoke at some point about grade level configurations. I mean, and again, my whole career has been centered around middle schools. I've been principal of middle schools. I've worked in middle schools. I've taught 6-8 configurations. I've taught 7-12 configurations. I mean, I understand that there's nothing tying it to a specific grade level, but where I think the confusion has come is that we have, as an administrative team, with what we thought was some encouragement from the SU board to have sort of this SU-wide discussion. You know, Mount Scutney has a unique sort of piece in this, but what we've been doing really is talking as a supervisory union about looking at different grade configurations. We've had some teachers that have even gone out. We had a group of teachers last year that went and visited Hartford Middle School, which is 6, 7, 8, and those teams mix 6, 7, and 8. So we've been, you know, this work has been ongoing, and quite frankly, I agree, Bill, that once we get a sense from those who are going to be at the implementation phase of what they are comfortable with, because quite frankly, if you're going to build a 7-8 or a 6-8 or a 5-8 middle school, you've got to make sure that you've got the capacity to do that with specials and resources and school counseling and supports and all of those pieces, you know, so that you kind of spread that out over the right number of kids. It's one of the problems Weathersfield has had is that some years when they have a large fifth grade, they'll bring one of those fifth graders up. I think Anne-Marie said that is a lot. They'll bring one of those fifth grades up. By the way, not both fifth grades. They'll bring one of those fifth grades up to be on the middle school team. There's been a lot of discomfort among the staff about having those juxtapositions and changes from year to year. They want to try to build capacity and continuity with the middle school program. And I think the other conversation, you know, once we get clarity and we deliver that clarity to all of the boards or the SU board, then I think you're right, Bill, there has to be this separate conversation. I mean, a separate conversation about what we do, because it may be that we do something, you know, a little different in Mount of Sutton. I think that's a different conversation than really studying, visiting, coming to grips with what constitutes a good middle. And what we found out with our middle school teachers, by the way, over half of them already have the middle level endorsement. So that was great news. And we did some research to get that. So I think it's a pretty active team, and I feel bad that it's gotten sort of, you know, tied up in this whole discussion about what would happen at Albert Bridge if we decided a good middle school or we had capacity for 6-8. I think that might be a separate conversation we're going to have as a Mount of Sutton board.
And well, it's a conversation you should have in which, you know, what makes a good middle school? You know, what sort of the pieces make up a good middle school? That's a conversation. It's got nothing to do with grade levels.
That's where we started. We started that work 8 months ago, you know, so we've gotten beyond that now. And I think people are embracing what they think is a good middle school, curriculum, instruction, assessment, all those kinds of things. I think we've gotten clarity there, but now we're getting down to, you know, because at some point you do have to look at capacity, and you've got to look at schedules, and you've got to look at numbers of kids, and you've got to see what would constitute a good team or good teams in these buildings, right?
Right, but that's going to be different in every single building.
It could be. It very well could be. Yeah. Absolutely.
Rebecca?
One of my concerns, and I've seen this often, is that these are some really important discussions which will impact on the students, but I don't hear the voices of parents. I don't hear the voices of the community engaged in this conversation. It becomes only the voices of educators, and nothing wrong with that, but I think that we need to get parents on board, and just like with what happened with the strategic plan, so that this isn't something that then needs to be sold to the community, but it is something that is part of the community. The community can help share this with other community members, and that really bothers me, David, that I thought the strategic plan seemed to be great. I mean, they apparently created forums to had barbecues, I think, but to get the parents involved, to get their to let them be part of this, because it should be a decision that should not be made by just educators. It really does need, we need to be transparent with all that we do, so that the community can feel and that, okay, this is going to work for my children, because whatever you do will impact also on parents. And they need to know that whether you go to a 6-7-8 model or 7-8 model, that, you know, what exactly does that mean? Who, you know, what kind of curriculum are you talking about? What kind of capacity, what does capacity mean to them? Will my children be with older kids? Will they be with younger kids? And those are questions that they can ask teachers and get input from. This is the implication, or this is the impact it would have. So I just want to encourage you to please try and get the community parents involved when you can in these conversations.
And so, Rebecca, let me just respond to that quickly, because I think, again, this might be a Mount of Sutton-y issue and an Albert. You have to understand that middle school configurations in those other buildings have always involved 5, 6, 7, and 8. I mean, the parents are used to that. They're used to their younger kids being with the older kids. Obviously, I mean, when we start talking about, you know, a pure middle school model, they'll certainly be those kinds of, I hope, there'll be those kinds of discussions. But I think what you're talking about, Rebecca, and getting community input or parent input around those configurations. At least I'm not hearing the Heartland Board or the Wethersfield Board or staff, you know, wanting that kind of engagement. I do hear that here at Mount Escutney, and I'm not opposed to that. And it might be because, you know, Albert Bridge parents, let's say we did have a 6-8 middle school in Mount Escutney, and we were thinking about bringing sixth grade over. I mean, those sixth graders have never been with those older students, right? But that's not the case in the other buildings. It's only specific to Mount Escutney and to Albert Bridge. I'm not opposed to parental input, but I'm just saying that I don't think we need to engage parents across the SU in this conversation because they're already doing it in those other two districts. It's already part of what they do. But I think Mount Escutney is going to need that kind of fleshing out at some point. I agree with you completely.
Well,
and that's one of the, that's one of the things I'm going to talk to the task force about on Thursday.
I think when it's time for us to engage with the parents, my suggestion would be that we, as a board, write a letter to the parents and community and invite their participation from us.
Yeah, I think that would be a good idea. Bill, I saw you seemed a little bit, I mean, what are you thinking? You thinking Heartland wants to engage their parents?
I think in any sort of, you know, when you're creating a vision that is district wide, you have to engage parents on some level, district wide. You just can't say, oh, they're used to it. That's not how you create a vision, David. That's not how you sell something in which your teachers have been working on. I do agree with Elizabeth, and I agree with you to some extent, is with the parent engagement in the different districts are going to be much different. But, you know, if your plan is, and I'm saying your plan and the admin plan, is to create a unified middle school vision SU-wide, you're going to have to engage all communities with that. Not necessarily on the same level, but, you know, I think you're setting yourself up for failure.
Why would you engage Wethersfield when they've had a 6-7-8 middle school for 10 years?
You would engage Wethersfield, David, because you are creating an SU vision. You're creating a vision, and anytime you create a vision,
I'm not creating a vision.
This committee is creating a vision. You are creating a plan, okay? And that plan may include X, Y, and Z. And so this is an...
Don't you think that task force of teachers needs to get clear on what that vision is first?
Did I say that you have to get? No, but what you're saying is you're telling Rebecca that the only parent outreach needs to be with the Escutney board. That's what I'm hearing. And really, I think that's just poor planning on SU wide. Okay, so that's just poor planning. That's poor. I'll throw it out there. That's just poor. Yeah, never mind. I won't say what I want to say. So basically, you know, I agree with Rebecca. You're going to at some point have to engage parents and boards if you're going to create an SU vision for middle school. Okay. At least on some level. And just because the Escutney School District is a unique situation doesn't mean that if you want this to be successful, you don't have to engage the Wethersfield Committee. You don't have to engage the Heartland it's, I mean, that's just, that makes absolutely no sense to me. And I'm going to shut up now because now I'm agitated.
Well, I plan to bring this issue back to the task force on Thursday. It's never come up until the Mount of Scutney board brought it up, you know, at the last meeting. And because it certainly impacts Albert Bridge, if in fact we move in that direction. But I'm going to, I'll certainly bring it up with sincerity and integrity and just see what we feel it would be necessary. I've been reporting out to both all the other boards, Heartland and Wethersfield, on a regular basis, much like I have with all of you, especially if it impacts. And it's never come up. Community forums, parent engagement has never come up in those other districts. And I'm just saying that. So I understand the uniqueness of this situation because it does, those grade levels cross over two buildings. I get that. But again, I just don't want to create a crisis where it doesn't exist, but I think the best bet would be to take it back to the task force. That's my, and we can also bring it to the SU board meeting and see what the boards think about, you know. I will tell you right now that task force, as they do their work and the people are leading that task force, I don't know if they have the bandwidth to set up, you know, 3-4 community forums and get input. I just don't know that they do. They're just trying to get from one day to the next, but they also don't want to let this middle school thing fade because they felt commissioned by the boards originally. And I'll have to go back through the minutes, but we've talked about engaging the middle school for a long time in this SU and getting those middle school teachers and kids more engaged in a developmentally appropriate way. This is not a new concept to our SU.
Okay.
It's just a matter of
thank you, David. Elizabeth, can we move on, please?
Yep, let's move on. I think the last thing on our agenda was talking about the meeting structure and how decisions are made. And I'm bringing it back to the document that I sent out to the Supervisory Union Board, in which I, in preparing for a panel on how to have non-confrontational meetings, I learned quite a bit through the sources that I was pointed to. And a couple of things came to mind, or a couple of things that I learned included having a, regardless of whether there is any community input at a particular meeting, having a kind of scripted welcoming statement saying that we are actually a board here to model behavior for students. That is what a school board, one of its missions actually. So we'll talk about that part at the SU meeting on Monday, but I'd like to suggest that for our board, one of the reasons that people become disgruntled and when they come to a board meeting, it's their last stop. They're already really mad. They may have already gone through the protocol of talking with teachers, talking with principals, talking with the superintendent. And now they're coming to the board because they haven't gotten an answer that they wanted anywhere along the line. How to address that. One of the reasons that parents, or it was pointed out that one of the reasons that parents get upset in the first place is that they're not included in decisions. So I would like to suggest that any big decisions that we make, we gather input from community members and parents, and that we be more inclusive with, we don't have to have parents make decisions, but we gather their input and include them in the research and include them in the process.
And I wanted to bring that to, I'm not saying that that is what we are going to do, but I thought it would be a good point of discussion. Bill?
Thank you, Elizabeth. I think this spans out more than just how to include parents more. I think it also spans out on how to include board members more. I think it's difficult for school administrators to switch roles from their role within the school community and then their role within this meeting. There's a big difference between facilitating and managing. And I think the one thing I'd like to point out is that, you know, admin are neither facilitators or managers at school board meetings. And I have to say that the last few meetings, I have felt managed on some level by school administrators in these meetings. And so I'm just expressing my feelings. And I don't want to feel that way. I don't want to feel managed because I'm not supposed to feel managed. I'm supposed to be here and have a discussion with my fellow board members with input from school administrators who are technically our employees. And that's how I want to feel, having a discussion and to be able to bring up ideas and to be able to communicate with parents and community members and to be able to have a path to come up with solutions to create a school district that is truly exceptional. And I think this is going to be a long-term discussion for me in particular on how to change the culture and the roles within these school board meetings. So thank you for bringing this up, Elizabeth.
Thanks, Bill. Does anybody else have any thoughts about this? Davis, I see you're getting closer to the screen. Does that mean you have thoughts about this?
I'm just reading over the policy, or the document that you sent us to see if I have any thoughts, but nothing is clearly out.
Rebecca, thoughts?
Well, I thank you, Bill, for bringing up some of the issues that you raised, because I think that that I'm concerned about public education. It's not so much what's being done. It's more around what isn't being done, and I think that this can be a great time for us to look at that and look at how things are done or have been done. And begin to engage in a conversation on, I just love that, Bill. How do we build an exceptional school district? I just love that. We can get our arms around that. I know that these are some challenging times, but I just really sense that all the people that I'm having this conversation with at these meetings really seem to be in the same place. It's like, how do we move forward during this really stressful, challenging time? I think the conversation is really important Elizabeth, what you said earlier around we should be, I wrote it down, we as a board, we want to model behavior for our students. And that is so important, you know, for our students, for our community. That's just so important right now.
I agree with you. I think that in any time of turmoil, there's a way to come out better. There actually is always a way to come out better. COVID has certainly shown us where our deepest problems are, and as if we didn't know where they were before. But we definitely have been shown the possibilities of how to fix things. We just need to take the time and energy towards thinking through some of the ways we can get there. And that comes through discussion and putting it all out on the table. And having lots of voices we don't want to talk into a vacuum. Having lots of voices, even if, sometimes people say dumb things, but the message is still really strong and valuable. Nancy, I haven't called on you. What do you think about all of this?
Well, I have a lot of thoughts, and I don't want to get too far back into the old conversation that created the problems. But I understand where Bill's coming from, because it looks like sometimes we're just being told this is what we're going to do, and we haven't been part of the conversation. And I really, David, I don't remember being told about the middle school task force. I must have missed it. But I don't agree with Bill on some things, because there is a middle school concept that I don't know if you're trying to improve it with the task force. I don't even know what the task force is supposed to be doing. But obviously, we have a specific problem in our town. And I would want to have our town specifically meet as a group, be invited on Zoom, because it's to the interest of the big change would be to our school. Apparently it's not a change for Weathersfield or Hartwood. So I'm between both of you, but we have never had a conversation in a board meeting about the middle school, and somehow we're going to have to do that at some point.
Thank you, Nancy. Davis, are you still reading the document?
Yeah, no, I've been perusing it. I mean, I think just generally, I think that there is more of this that we can do intentionally at our meetings. I know that making space for community members, really even just remembering to cite it before we move on from topics or before we vote on items. I mean, it can seem like a simple thing to forget, but just kind of cueing that a lot of the time can be helpful. I'm noticing that under the public comment on agenda items. I know that having attended, a lot of Windsor Select Board meetings, there's been a real emphasis on trying to make that process of seeking out engagement more intentional. And I think there's been some success there. So that may be something to consider, and really just kind of keep in the forefront of our mind. because we do want our our community members to take part.
All right, well, thank you all for your input, and I think we'll continue to have this discussion. I do plan to include in the next agenda ways that people can participate. I think it's a good reminder for the public anyway that they can. And I think I probably will include at least some of the elements of that kind of scripted introduction to public participation. With it, as long as you are all okay with that. I see some nods. All right. And with that, is there anything else? I don't think there's anything else on the agenda. I apologize for going long. But it was all important. And so, Wendy, it's a self meeting. I'm going to take a motion to end the meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Bill, how do you vote for ending the meeting?
Aye.
Rebecca?
Aye.
Davis?
Aye.
Nancy?
Aye.
And I am an aye. Thank you all so much for this fruitful discussion this evening. When we had a second, it was Rebecca. Okay. I'll see those of you who wish to be there on Tuesday, and I'll see hopefully all of you on Monday. And have a great week. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Elizabeth.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.